Laudator Jesus Christus. You're listening to Vatican News. And welcome this morning to our live coverage of the Pope's 32nd apostolic voyage outside of Italy. The Holy Father is on a trip to Southeast Asia. He is in Thailand right now, the first stop on his visit, which will later this week take him also to Japan. My name is Christopher Wells. I am your host this morning for the Holy Father's meeting with priests, religious men and women, consecrated men and women, seminarians and catechists at the sanctuary of Blessed Nicholas Bunkert Kitbamrung, a blessed from Thailand. And the Holy Father, for those of you watching on television, has just arrived. For those of you listening in on radio as well, I would like to greet everybody this morning, especially those joining us by way of our collaborators, including Radio Luce, We Are One Body Radio, Catholic Faith Network, Shalom World TV, Salt and Light TV, EWTN TV, Catholic TV, and CBS News. Good morning, one and all. This is the second full day of the Holy Father's visit. After a very busy day yesterday, the Holy Father this morning will be having a number of events, all in Bangkok. He is meeting first with priests, religious men and women, seminarians and catechists, as we said. And afterwards, immediately following this meeting, he will be meeting with the bishops of Thailand as well as the bishops of the Conference of Asian Bishops Conference, the Federation of Asian Bishops Conferences, the FABC. That is the next event. In fact, I need to back up a little bit. This first meeting is at the Parish of St. Peter, where the Holy Father will be praying for vocations, as well as delivering a discourse. The first event, after a greeting from a bishop, will be a witness given by one of the religious women. Then the Holy Father will give his discourse. The Parish of St. Peter was founded in 1840. It was originally constructed of bamboo. The first stone building was built in 1880. Excuse me, the first stone was placed in 1880. It was completed in 1886 and was later restored and built up in 1910. It was completely rebuilt in 1970, beginning in 1970, and inaugurated on December 11th, 1972. It is in a fairly modern style. And for those of you listening in on the radio, we can now see a number of a pretty fair-sized crowd coming out with Thai and Vatican flags waving. Everybody seems in good mood. It's a beautiful sunny day this morning. As the Holy Father is preparing for his entrance. Yesterday we saw the Holy Father make his first visits. He spoke with civil authorities and members of the diplomatic corps after meeting with the Prime Minister of Thailand. Later, he met with the Supreme Patriarch, the Buddhist Supreme Patriarch of Thailand. He then visited a hospital in Bangkok and was able to meet not only with the medical staff of the St. Louis Hospital, but also with a number of the patients there. He also had a meeting with the King of Thailand, Rama the 10th. And his last event yesterday was the Holy Mass in the National Stadium of Bangkok, where the Holy Father celebrated the liturgy for the memorial of the presentation of the Blessed Virgin Mary. And the Holy Father is now entering the sanctuary, dedicated to Blessed Nicholas Bunkert Kitbamrung, close to the place where the Blessed was born. It is dedicated to the first priest martyr of Thailand. And the actual sanctuary was completed in 2003. Inside are the relics of Blessed Nicholas, who was beatified in 2000 by Pope John Paul II. In 2012, Cardinal Kit Bunchu blessed the statue of Blessed Nicholas, which was erected during the Year of Faith to recall his example and his witness of faith. The sanctuary also includes a museum that commemorates the heroic virtue and the life of the Blessed and his great contribution to the Thai Christian community. And now we can see inside the church where the Holy Father has arrived. And is headed, I believe, to the image of the Blessed Virgin Mary with a bouquet of flowers. And the Holy Father offers a bouquet of white roses and lilies to the Blessed Mother. At the image of Saint Peter, and offers a brief prayer there. And pauses briefly before the tabernacle and prays silently for a few moments before our Lord in the Most Holy Eucharist, reposing in the tabernacle beneath the image of the risen Lord. And a warm round of applause for the Holy Father as the event begins. And the Holy Father is greeted at the beginning of the event.
Responsabile della vita consacrata, presente la tutti noi qui presenti, consacrate e consacrati, sacerdoti, seminaristi, catechisti e fedeli, provenienti dalle varie diocesi, nell'esprimere il nostro cordiale grato benvenuto.
The greeting of a religious sister who introduces the event. Now we have the address by Bishop Joseph Pradhan Sridharudun Sil, Brazilian. Most Holy Father, it is my honor to present to you this gathering of around 1,000 persons, priests, men and women religious, consecrated persons, seminarians, novices, and catechists here at St. Peter's Parish. As Thai Catholics, we are part of the Asian continent where people take great pride in their religious and cultural values, which include love of silence and contemplation, simplicity, harmony, detachment, nonviolence, a spirit of hard work, discipline, frugal living, the thirst for learning and philosophical inquiry. Rapid change has been taking place within Thai society, giving rise to both positive and negative effects. Many of our people face difficult economic, cultural, and moral situations due to various reasons centered around poverty, lack of opportunity, and personal hardship of many kinds. This context has inevitable effects on family life and values. Another factor for Thailand is that it is an aging society with all the challenges accompanying this social trend. So we must give more attention to pastoral work with senior citizens, especially those left alone at home.
ตั้งแต่แรกเริ่มของพระศาสนาจักรหลังจากธรรมทูตโดมินิกันสองท่านได้หว่านเมล็ดพันธุ์แห่งความเชื่อบนผืนแผ่นดินของเราจากนั้นบรรดานักบวชชายหญิงทั้งที่เป็นชนพื้นเมืองและต่างชาติก็ค่อยๆเข้ามาสืบสานพันธกิจในพระศาสนาจักรท้องถิ่นณวันนี้เรามีคณะนักบวชหญิง 35 คณะ
Since the beginning of the Church, when two Dominican missionaries sowed the seeds of faith in our motherland, men and women religious, both local and missionary, have gradually taken up their place in this Church. As of now, there are 35 female religious congregations with 1,378 members, 22 male religious congregations with 456 members, 7 societies of apostolic life with 41 members, plus 3 monastic orders with 164 members. They're like a small candle lit by Jesus for the poor, the vulnerable, and the excluded. Evangelization started in 1669, and up to this moment has been continually responding in mission to the signs of the time. The Thai Church nowadays is facing the same situation as other countries in the world, namely a crisis of decreasing vocation. Nevertheless, we are aware of our sense of the Church and moving ahead together to proclaim the good news. Therefore, the Catholic Bishops' Conference of Thailand has proudly established the Thai Mission Society, the TMS, for sharing our priests and religious with neighboring countries. It is interesting that a good number of candidates is increasing in this sector.
ดังนั้นสภาประมุขบาทหลวงคาทอลิกแห่งประเทศไทยมีความภูมิใจที่ได้ก่อตั้งสถาบันแห่งธรรมทูตไทยเพื่อแบ่งปันบาทหลวงนักบวชและคารวาสให้กับพระศาสนาจักรในประเทศเพื่อนบ้านข้อสังเกตที่ดีก็คือมีจำนวนผู้ที่สนใจสมัครเป็นสมาชิกของสถาบันนี้เพิ่มขึ้น
We see a church working for education, both formal in both the city and the countryside. We see a church working effectively to promote human dignity and taking up the challenge of fighting human trafficking through the agency of Talithakum Thailand. We see a church taking good care of children, especially those who are poor and abandoned. We see a church empowering women, especially single mothers, sex workers, and those knowing abuse. We see a church providing health care, serving with compassion in so many different ways. We see a church accompanying youth, identifying them as an essential population in our community, demanding our attention in mission so that they can be empowered for being church into the future. Your Holiness, the Thai Church serves so many in so many ministries. How much we do is not so important, as what truly matters is that we are a living witness of God's love, compassion, and justice in the midst of society. So we value your presence with us today. We thank you and humbly ask you to share your words of wisdom to enlighten and guide us as we continue on our way of following God and serving his people as shown to us in the life of Jesus, his Son.
ของเราในการทำภารกิจเพื่อพวกเขาจะสามารถเป็นความหวังพระศาสนาจักรในอนาคตข้าแต่บิดาผู้ศักดิ์สิทธิ์พระศาสนาจักรในประเทศไทยรับใช้ประชากรพระเจ้าในหลากหลายภารกิจเรากระทำมากหรือน้อยนั้นไม่ใช่สำคัญแต่การตอบรับความจริงที่ว่า เรายินดีเป็นประจักษ์พยานทรงชีวิตแห่งความรักความเมตตาและความยุติธรมของพระเจ้าท่ามกลางสังคมเราถือว่าการที่พระองค์เสด็จมาประทับอยู่ท่ามกลางพวกเราในวันนี้นั้นมีคุณค่าอันสูงส่งขอขอบคุณพระองค์และเราวอนขอให้พระองค์ทรงแบ่งปันวาจาแห่งปรีชาญาณ เพื่อที่จะจันลงใจและชี้นำเราในขณะที่เรากำลังติดตามพระเจ้าไปและรับใช้ประชากรของพระองค์เช่นที่ปรากฏในชีวิตของพระเยซูคริสต์พระบุตรของพระองค์
That was the greeting of Bishop Joseph Pradhan Sridharunsil, a Salesian bishop who has care of religious in Thailand. And now we'll hear from Sister Benedetta, who will give her testimony.
ด้วยดวงใจที่กตัญญูรู้คุณต่อพระเจ้าสำหรับพระพรมากมายที่พระองค์ทรงโปรดประทานแก่เราให้เราร่วมกันสรรเสริญพระองค์ด้วยบทเพลงหนทางแห่งรักขอเชิญพี่น้องยืนขับบทเพลงหน้า 24
After a brief musical interlude.
Thank you.
Fede. Turn down. คนไทยแม้ส่วนใหญ่จะนับถือพระพุทธศาสนาแต่คริสตชนมีอิสระในการปฏิบัติศาสนกิจคนไทยหลายคนเปิดใจต่อข่าวดีของพระคริสต์เจ้าและพระองค์ประทานพระพรแห่งการกลับใจพระสันตบิดรผู้ศักดิ์สิทธิ์ความเรามีความยินดีที่จะนำเสนอประจักษ์พยานชีวิตของเบเนเดตตาจงรักดอนโอลานผู้ฝึกหัดในคณะซิสเตอร์เซเวเรียน Santo Padre, sebbene la maggioranza dei cittadini thai professano la religione buddista, tuttavia hanno cuore aperto alla buona notizia di Cristo Gesù, a Dio che ha donato la grazia della conversione. Le sia gradito ascoltare la testimonianza della fede di Benedetta Chonglak Don Oran, membro della Consecrazione Suole Severiane.
Santita.
And now we hear the witness and testimony of Benedetta. My name is Benedetta Chonglak Donoran Thi, and I was born in 1975. I was baptized in 2012 and am now a postulant in the Congregation of the Missionaries of Mary, the Severians.
คณะธรรมทูตแห่งพระนางมารีซาเวเรียนครอบครัวของดิฉันนับถือศาสนาพุทธทุกคนดำเนินชีวิตตามหลักคำสอนทางพุทธศาสนาเป็นอย่างดีเมื่อก่อนดิฉันก็ดำเนินชีวิตเช่นนั้นเช่นกันดิฉันเชื่อว่าการทำความดีสามารถทำให้เราหลุดพ้นและไปสวรรค์ได้
And my family, everybody is a Buddhist, and they all live according to the Buddhist teachings that I also used to believe in. To do good is what frees us and what brings us to heaven. Those who do good will receive good. Why should Jesus take the consequences of our sins in our stead? While I was studying, I had a chance to go once to the Immaculate Conception Church that is in my village. At that time, I was 15, and the Sisters of the Daughters of Charity invited us girls for the Sunday Mass. I went there with my friends, and when I entered the church, I saw the statue of a woman. I did not know who she was, but I was struck by her beauty and her way of looking at me. Then I saw the image of a crucified man. It scared me. From that day on, I started attending the Sunday Mass on my own will. I was attracted by the beauty of that woman, and I wanted to know her better. This is how I started knowing Mary and Jesus more and more. I did not believe that Jesus was God, though, and I asked myself, how can a man erase the sins of other men? I had a lot of trust in Mary. I prayed the rosary that was taught to me by the sisters, and I used to attend the Sunday celebrations with the Christians. I continued studying and working in the same school. Then, at 33 years old, I decided to resign, following my ideal to dedicate myself to the good of society, as a volunteer teacher going to the mountain villages. I was on my way when in Chiang Mai, I met Father Raffaele Menenti, a PM missionary. So I decided to go with him to work at Angel's Home, a house for handicapped children, which is under the supervision of Our Lady of Mercy Church in the Nonthaburi province, and was run by the missionaries of Mary, the Severians. After a while, out of curiosity, I went to see the group of catechumens. I wanted to know what they were doing. I learned a bit more about Jesus, and I had a chance to hear the gospel. I could feel his word working inside my heart like a blade. I was disturbed by the demands of this word, yet I did not want to give up. However, to keep listening to that word was like playing with fire. The feeling of uneasiness and discomfort kept growing. One night, in a state of uncomfortable half-sleep, I heard a voice that ordered me, "Go work elsewhere. Go away from these people." Another voice said, "T, I love you." This last voice brought into my heart a lot of serenity and peace. After 1 year, I asked to receive baptism. The priest refused and asked me to wait some more. The truth is that I was not yet ready to receive the sacrament of baptism. I only wanted that feeling of uneasiness to go away, but I was not asking for God's mercy. Slowly, slowly, I came to realize that baptism is not the fruit of one's merit. We receive it as a gift from God. I attended catechism classes for another year. Only then, kneeling down, did I ask for God's mercy. Grace came to me as a conversion of heart. Through baptism, I died and was reborn again in the Lord Jesus Christ. I let myself be overcome by God's love and by his patience that awaited his daughter to come back to him. I would have never believed without having the experience of God's love. God is love, and he has manifested himself in Jesus. I met him. This is the good news for my life. The same good news of which St. Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles, says, "Because of the grace given me by God to be a minister of Christ Jesus to the Gentiles, in the priestly service of the gospel of God, so that the offering of the Gentiles may be acceptable, sanctified by the Holy Spirit." The same good news for which I now wish to donate my life. And she greets the Holy Father and bows to him at the end of her address. And now we expect to hear from our Holy Father, Pope Francis.
ที่จะแบ่งปันกับพวกเราตั้งแต่อยู่ที่โรมก็มีหลายข่าวสารนะคะมาให้นะคะแล้ววันนี้เราก็มีลาภนะได้ฟังสิ่งที่พระองค์จะตรัสกับเราโดยเฉพาะสำหรับพระศาสนาจักรคาทอลิกไทยสำหรับกลุ่มที่เป็นพระสงฆ์นักบวชครูคำสอนสามเณรแล้วก็คริสตชนสันตุปาเด
Ola la invitiamo a condividere con noi una sua esortazione.
And now our Holy Father Pope Francis. And a brief round of laughter with a little microphone difficulty. I thank Bishop Joseph for his words of welcome in your name. I'm happy to see all of you, to listen to you, to share in your joy, and to sense how the Spirit is at work in our midst. I thank all of you, catechists, priests, consecrated men and women, and seminarians for the gift of this time together. Thanks too to Benedetta for sharing her life and testimony. As I listened to her, I felt gratitude for the lives of all those missionaries, men and women, whose lives of service left their mark. Benedetta, you told us about the Daughters of Charity. I'd like first to express gratitude for all those consecrated persons who, by the silent martyrdom of fidelity and daily commitment, have borne great fruit. I do not know if they were able to appreciate or taste the fruits of their commitment, but without a doubt, their lives were capable of bringing about much good. They were a promise of hope. For this reason, at the beginning of our meeting, I would ask you especially to keep in mind all those catechists and elderly consecrated men and women who drew us into the love and friendship of Jesus Christ. Let us give thanks for them and for the elderly members of our communities who could not be present today. Tell them that the Pope sends them a grateful blessing and asks in turn for their blessing. I believe that the history of each of our vocations is marked by those people who helped us discover and discern the fire of the Spirit. It is so good and at the same time important to be thankful. Gratitude is always a powerful weapon. Only if we are able to contemplate and feel genuine gratitude for all those ways we have experienced God's love, generosity, solidarity, and trust, as well as his forgiveness, patience, forbearance, and compassion, will we allow the Spirit to grant us the freshness that can renew and not simply patch up our life and mission.
Pensemos en ellos. Demos gracias.
So let us think of them with gratitude, and standing on their shoulders, may we too feel called to be men and women who will help bring about the new life that that the Lord bestows on us. As those called to apostolic fruitfulness, called to struggle valiantly for the things that the Lord loves and for which He gave His life, let us ask for the grace for our hearts to beat in unison with His own. I would even ask you to be wounded by that same love, to have that same passion for Jesus and for His kingdom.
Podemos preguntarnos todo cómo cultivar la fecundidad.
Here we can ask ourselves, how do we cultivate apostolic fruitfulness?
Podemos hacer todos y cada uno responderla desde su corazón. A ver si la hermana traduce lo que no está en el.
Benedetta, you spoke of how the Lord first attracted you to Himself by beauty. And you can ask yourselves that question and respond in your own heart.
Para mí no es fácil comunicarme con ustedes a través de un aparato. No es fácil.
It's not easy.
Pero ustedes tienen buena voluntad.
Gracias. But it's clear that you have a good will. Benedetta, you spoke of how the Lord first attracted you to Himself by beauty. It was the beauty of an image of Our Lady whose special gaze pierced your heart and made you want to know her better. Who is that woman? It had nothing to do with words, abstract ideas, or cold syllogisms. It all started with a beautiful look that captivated you. What great wisdom was hidden in your words? Let us be alert to beauty, to a sense of wonder, capable of opening up new horizons and raising new questions. A consecrated life incapable of openness to surprises is only half a life. To the grace the joys and sorrows of the surprises. And now the Pope's brief off script words are being translated in Thai for the audience.
ทำให้เราทุกๆวันตื่นเต้นทำให้เราทุกวันมีอะไรใหม่เพราะฉะนั้นก็ต้องพยายามที่จะถึงจุดนี้เพื่อจะเป็นนักบวชที่ดี
El Señor no nos llamó para enviarnos al mundo a imponer obligaciones.
The Lord did not call us and send us forth into the world to impose obligations on people or lay heavier burdens than those they already have, which are many. But rather to share joy, a beautiful, new, and surprising horizon. I really like the words of Benedict XVI, which I consider not only true, but also prophetic for our times. The church does not grow by proselytizing, but by attraction. Proclaiming Christ means showing that to believe in and follow Him is not only something right and true, but also something beautiful, capable of filling life with new splendor and profound joy, even in the midst of difficulties, quoting Evangelii Gaudium. This means we are not afraid to look for new symbols and images, for that particular music, which can help awaken in the Thai people the amazement that the Lord wants to give us. Let us not be afraid to continue enculturating the gospel.
Lo repito, no tengamos miedo de querer inculturar el evangelio.
I repeat, let us not be afraid to continue inculturating the gospel. We need to seek new ways of transmitting the word, ways that are capable of mobilizing and awakening a desire to know the Lord. Who is that man? Who are these people who follow a man who is crucified?
Preparando este encuentro, pude leer con cierto dolor que para muchos.
As I prepared for this meeting, I read with some pain that for many people Christianity is a foreign faith, a religion for foreigners.
Esta realidad nos impulsa a buscar la manera de animarnos.
This should spur us to find ways to talk about the faith in dialect, like a mother who sings lullabies to her child. With that same intimacy, let us give faith a Thai face and flesh, which involves much more than making translations. It's about letting the gospel be stripped of fine but foreign garb, to let it sing with the native music of this land and inspire the hearts of our brothers and sisters with the same beauty that set our own hearts on fire. I encourage you to pray to Our Lady, to the one who by the beauty of her gaze first captivated Benedetta, and say with childlike confidence, obtain for us now a new ardor born of the resurrection, that we may bring to all the gospel of life which triumphs over death. Give us a holy courage to seek new paths, that the gift of unfading beauty may reach every man and woman, again quoting Evangelii Gaudium. Mary's gaze impels us to look where she looks, to turn our eyes to that other gaze, and to do whatever he tells us. His is a gaze that captivates because it is able to penetrate appearances, to find and celebrate the authentic beauty present in every person. It is a gaze that, as the gospel teaches us, shatters all determinisms, fatalisms, and standards. Where many saw only a sinner, a blasphemer, a tax collector, an evildoer, or even a traitor, Jesus was able to see apostles.
Y esa es la belleza que su mirada nos invita a anunciar. Una mirada que se mete adentro.
Such is the beauty that his gaze invites us to proclaim, a gaze that transforms and brings out the best in others.
Pensando en el comienzo de la vocación de tantos de ustedes, ¿cuántos en su juventud participaron en las actividades de jóvenes que querían vivir el Evangelio?
As for the first stirrings of your vocation, many of you in your early years took part in the activities of young people who wanted to put the gospel into practice and to go out into the cities to visit the needy, the neglected, and even the despised, orphans, and the elderly. Surely many of you were in turn visited by the Lord, who made you see that he was calling you to give everything away, to leave yourselves behind, and in that very moment, in that very movement, to find yourselves. In the faces of those we encounter on the street, we can discover the beauty of being able to treat one another as brothers and sisters. We see them no longer as orphans, derelicts, outcasts, or the despised. Now each of them has the face of a brother or sister redeemed by Jesus Christ. This is what it is to be a Christian. Can holiness somehow be understood apart from this lively recognition of the dignity of each human being? Quotation from Gaudete et Exaltate. I'd like to encourage all those among you who on a daily basis spend your lives serving Jesus and your brothers and sisters, as Bishop Joseph proudly pointed out when introducing you. So many of you manage to see beauty where others see only contempt, abandonment, or an object of sexual gratification. In this way, you are a concrete sign of the Lord's mercy, alive and at work, a sign of the anointing of the Holy One in these lands. Such anointing calls for prayer. Apostolic fruitfulness requires and is sustained by fidelity to deep prayer. How many deep prayer like that of those elderly people who constantly pray the rosary? How many of us have received the faith from our grandparents, from seeing them doing their household chores, rosary in hand, sanctifying their entire day? This is contemplation in action, making God part of the little things of each day. It's vital that the Church today be able to proclaim the gospel to all, in all places, on all occasions, without hesitation and without fear. As people who every morning in their face-to-face conversation with the Lord are sent forth anew. Without prayer, our life and mission loses all its meaning, strength, and fervor.
En todos los lugares, en todas las ocasiones, sin demora y sin miedo. Como personas que cada mañana, en ese cara a cara con el Señor, vuelven a ser enviadas. Sin la oración, toda nuestra vida y misión pierde sentido, pierde fuerza y fervor. Le pido a la traductora que traduzca lo que sigue ahora que no está en el texto. Si a ustedes les falta la oración, cualquier trabajo que hacen no tiene sentido, no tiene fuerza, no tiene valor. La oración es el centro de todo.
ชีวิตคนเราไม่มีความหมายไม่มีกำลังและไม่มี ความศรัทธาเฉพาะคำภาวนาที่นำชีวิตคนเราและภารกิจคนเราในทางที่ถูกต้องและมีพลังคือพลังของพระเจ้าในตัวเรา
Decía San Pablo VI que uno de los peores enemigos de la evangelización.
Saint Paul VI said that one of the worst obstacles to evangelization is the lack of fervor in the Evangelii Nuntiandi.
Y el fervor para el religioso, para la religiosa, para el sacerdote.
For religious priests and catechists, that fervor is nurtured by double encounter with the face of the Lord and with the faces of our brothers and sisters. We too need to find the space to be able to return to the source and drink of its life-giving waters.Immersed in myriad responsibilities, may we always seek that quiet place where we can remember in prayer that the Lord has already saved the world and that we are asked, in union with Him, to make the salvation felt by all.
Nuevamente, gracias por vuestra vida. Gracias por vuestro testimonio.
Once again, I thank you for your lives, your witness,and your generous commitment. I ask you, please, not to yield to the temptation of thinking that you are few in number. Instead, think of yourselves as little tools in the Lord's creative hands. He will be writing with your lives the finest pages of the history of salvation in these lands. And please remember to pray for me and ask others to do the same. Thank you. Those were the words of our Holy Father, Pope Francis.With words of encouragement to the priests, religious, and seminarians who are present both within the church and outside the building. Now the Holy Father is going to lead us in a prayer for vocations. And this is adapted from the Holy Father's own message on the 51st World Day.Of prayer for vocations. Lord of the harvest, bless young people with the gift of courage to respond to your call. Open their hearts to great ideals and to great things. Inspire all your disciples to mutual love and giving.For vocations blossom in the good soil of faithful people.
Inculca en los que viven la vida religiosa, sirven en ministerios parroquiales.
Instill those in religious life, parish ministries, and families with the confidence and grace to invite others to embrace the bold and noble path of a life consecrated to you.Unite us to Jesus through prayer and sacrament so that we may cooperate with you in building your reign of mercy and truth, of justice and peace.
Amen.
Amen.
พวกเราทุกๆคน
เตรียม
เอล่า26ค่ะ
and the apostolic blessing
benedicat vos omnipotens Deus Pater, et Filius, et Spiritus Sanctus.
Amen. Amen. Affidiamo la nostra vita al Signore Gesù. Chiediamo la forza per poter vivere fedele al suo insegnamento con incanto la via di Gesù.
And the Holy Father, at the conclusion of this event, is presenting the sanctuary with a beautiful golden monstrance. Holy Father will now, amid some traditional songs, descends from the sanctuary area. He'll be meeting with bishops here in just a few moments, but in the meantime he has a chance to at least walk through the crowds and shake hands with those especially religious men and women who are there to see him. Holy Father is now leaving the church. His next meeting, there's actually a fair crowd here outside the building. As with many events, it's hard to find or rather, it's difficult to balance the need to be inside the churches, inside the sanctuaries, and still find space to accommodate as many people as possible. So there are very usually at papal events, there are spaces outside of the buildings themselves where people can gather, where they can get a glimpse of the Pope, where the Pope is able to walk amongst the people and greet them as well. And here, as in other places, there are also large screens set up so that the people can watch the events. And of course, the Holy Father is moving amongst the crowd and stopping from time to time to speak with some individuals. And kiss a baby or two. And of course the crowd is waving Thai flags and Vatican flags with some colorful umbrellas to keep the sun off. And again, as is pretty customary with popes, certainly in the amongst the last few pontificates, as the Holy Father does move amongst the people, he does take a few moments and actually spends time greeting individuals. Of course, most of the people that he passes by, at most he can reach out and touch their hands, but he does stop by briefly from time to time to actually stop and visit with people. And that's pretty traditional for the popes. We've seen that with certainly Benedict the 16th and John Paul II, with Paul the 6th as well. And and with their predecessors, I think, going back many, many years. The Holy Father is now preparing to meet with the Cardinal Archbishop of Bangkok and the Cardinal President of the Federation of Asian Bishops Conferences, the FABC. For the second part of this morning's events. The Cardinal of Thailand is Cardinal Krang Sak. He is going to briefly greet the Holy Father, and then we will have the Holy Father's address to the bishops. And they are actually receiving the Holy Father in the shrine of Nicholas Bunkert Kitbamrung. Who is the first Thai-born martyr priest. He was a catechist who instructed Salesian seminarians, all the while teaching Salesian priests the Thai language. He was actually imprisoned in 1941 when he was accused of collaborating with the French and accused of espionage. And in 1944, he died from tuberculosis after a long period of mistreatment, and so he is honored as a martyr. He was ordained in 1926. He was also a missionary in Vietnam. And his major relics are actually interred under the main altar at the Assumption Cathedral in Bangkok. His cause was begun in 1995 for canonization. After a petition by the faithful of Bangkok, which began some years earlier. And Kitbamrung was beatified in St. Peter's Square by Pope St. John Paul II in March of the year 2000, the Holy Year. For those listening on the radio, we're now seeing images of a group of pilgrims from China. And you can now hear the image has switched to the inside of the shrine where the Holy Father is greeting and being greeted by the bishops of Thailand and some members of the FABC.
Y In the name of the Bishops of Thailand,
this is Cardinal Kringsak.
Of Asian Bishop Conferences, I welcome you to Thailand. We are honored by your presence among us here in the shrine of Blessed Nicholas Bunker Kitbamrung, priests and martyrs. We are gathered with you, Holy Father, to listen as you speak to us of our role as shepherds of the little flock in Asia, the motherland of major traditional religions of the world, and of our role in and for the Church. Next year, in 2020, the Federation of Asian Bishop Conferences will celebrate its 50th anniversary with a General Assembly here in Bangkok. The theme will be FABC 2020, Journeying Together as Peoples of Asia. Our aim is to foster solidarity and co-responsibility for the welfare of the Church and society in Asia. Among the members of the FABC, we hope that this celebration will contribute to the new evangelization by enabling our lives, actions, and words to bear witness to Jesus and to the Gospel. As bishops of Thailand in particular, we wish to dedicate ourselves in a spirit of fraternal dialogue to the service of our Asian brothers and sisters, especially the poor and those who desire to know Christ and seek His truth. We decide also to be artisans for peace and reconciliation in this region, which has known many conflicts, displacement of people, and the scourge of human trafficking. The Church in Thailand wants to show to the world how society can be when the gospel and the spirituality of communion are put into practice. In this way, it will be possible for the disciples of Christ in Thailand to overcome social divisions. Holy Father, on behalf of my brothers bishops, I thank you again for being with us today and for your encouraging words to guide us in our journey together, that we may be living icons of the love of God for His people in Asia. We ask your blessing upon us and upon all of our communities. Thank you, Your Holiness.
That was Cardinal Francis Xavier Kringsak Koetawanich, the Archbishop of Bangkok. He's also the Vice President of the Catholic Bishops' Conference of Thailand. The Bishops' Conference was instituted in 1965 and is composed of the bishops of the two archdioceses and nine suffragan dioceses in the country. Now the Holy Father is going to be speaking. It's very interesting to see the bishops very attentive. One of them is already got pen in hand, ready to take notes. And it looks like we have a little difficulty with the mic once again. There we go. I thank His Eminence Colonel Francis Xavier Kringsak Koetawanich for his kind words of introduction and welcome. I'm happy to be with you and to share, even briefly, your joys and hopes, your projects and dreams, but also the challenges that you face as pastors of God's holy and faithful people. Thank you for your fraternal welcome.
Bunker Kitbamrung, que dedicó su vida
Our meeting takes place today at the shrine of Blessed Nicholas Bunkert Kitbamrung, who devoted his life to evangelization and catechesis, forming disciples of the Lord, primarily here in Thailand, but also in part of Vietnam and along the border with Laos, and who crowned his witness to Christ with martyrdom. Let us place our meeting under his watchful gaze, so that his example may inspire us with a great zeal for evangelization in all the local churches of Asia, so that we may increasingly become missionary disciples of the Lord, enabling his good news to spread like a fragrant balm throughout this great and beautiful continent. I realize that you are making plans for the 2020 General Assembly of the Federation of Asian Bishops Conferences, which will mark the 50th anniversary of its foundation. This is a fitting occasion to revisit those shrines where the missionary roots that left their mark on these lands are preserved, to be guided by the Holy Spirit in the footsteps of our first love. And to welcome with parousia a future that you yourselves must help develop and create. In this way, both the Church and society in Asia will benefit from a renewed and shared evangelical outreach, in love with Christ and capable of bringing others to share in that same love. You are living in the midst of a multicultural and multireligious continent, endowed with great beauty and prosperity, but troubled at the same time by poverty and exploitation at various levels. Rapid technological advancements can open up immense possibilities that make life easier, but can also result in the growth of consumerism and materialism, especially among young people. You have taken upon yourselves the concerns of your people, the scourge of drugs and human trafficking, the care of great numbers of migrants and refugees, poor working conditions, and the exploitation experienced by many laborers, as well as economic and social inequality between rich and poor. In the midst of these tensions stands the pastor, who struggles and intercedes with his people and for his people. The memory of the first missionaries who preceded us with courage, joy, and extraordinary stamina can help us take stock of our present situation and mission from a much broader and more transformative perspective. In the first place, that memory frees us from the belief that times past were always more favorable or better for the proclamation of the gospel. It also helps us to avoid taking refuge in fruitless discussions and ways of thinking that end up making us turn in on ourselves, paralyzing any kind of action. Let us learn from the saints who have gone before us, who confronted the difficulties of their own day, according Evangelii Gaudium.
Somos conscientes de que hay estructuras y mentalidades.
Let us cast aside everything that has stuck to us along the way and that makes it harder for us to press forward. We know that some ecclesial structures and mentalities can hamper efforts at evangelization.
Igualmente, las buenas estructuras sirven.
Yet even good structures are only helpful when there is a life constantly driving, sustaining, and assessing them. Ultimately, without new life and an authentic evangelical spirit, without the Church's fidelity to her own calling, any new structure will soon prove ineffective and detract from our important ministry of fervent prayer and intercession. As we contemplate missionary progress in these lands, one of the first lessons we learn is to be confident in the knowledge that it is the Holy Spirit Himself who goes before us and it gathers us together. He is the first to invite the Church to go forth to all those places where new narratives and paradigms are being formed. Bring the word of Jesus to the inmost soul of our cities and cultures. The Holy Spirit arrives in advance of missionaries and remains with them. The power of the Holy Spirit sustained and motivated the apostles and countless missionaries not to discount any land, people, culture, or situation. They did not look for places of guaranteed success. On the contrary, their guarantee lay in the certainty that no person or culture was a priori incapable of receiving the seed of life, happiness, and above all friendship that the Lord wants to sow in them. They did not expect a foreign culture to receive the gospel easily. Rather, they plunged into these new realities, convinced of the beauty of which they were bearers. All life has value in the eyes of the Master. They were bold and courageous because they knew that in the first place the gospel is a gift to be shared with and for everyone. Doctors of the law, sinners, tax collectors, prostitutes. With and for all sinners, then as now. I like to observe that the mission, even prior to things to be done or projects to be implemented, demands the cultivation of a gaze and a sense of smell. The mission calls for paternal and maternal concern because the sheep is only lost when the shepherd gives it up for lost, and not before.
Hace tres meses me visitó un misionero francés que trabaja desde hace
3 months ago. I received a visit from a French missionary who worked for about 40 years in the northern part of Thailand. He came with a group of about 50 people All mothers and fathers of families, very young. And he is about 50 years. And they're the first generation baptized. They were there with their children. He gave his whole life for these people, these 50 people, baptizing their children.
No dio por perdida esa oveja. La asumió. Uno de los puntos más hermosos de la evangelización es hacernos cargo de que la misión confiada a la iglesia.
As we contemplate, one of the most splendid aspects of evangelization is our realization that the mission entrusted to the church does not lie only in the proclamation of the gospel, but also in learning to believe the gospel and to let ourselves be laid hold of and transformed by it.
Aprender a creerle al Evangelio.
This means living and walking in the light of the Word of God that we are charged to proclaim. We do well to remember the words of the great Saint Paul VI. The Church is an evangelizer, but she begins by being evangelized herself. She is the community of believers, the community of hope lived and communicated, the community of brotherly love, and she needs to listen unceasingly to what she must believe, to her reasons for hoping, to the new commandment of love. That's from Evangelii Nuntiandi. In this way, the Church enters into the dynamic of conversion proclamation demanded of each disciple. Purified by the Lord, she becomes a witness by vocation, a church that goes forth, unafraid to take to the streets and come face to face with the lives of the people entrusted to her care, as a church able to be open in humility to the Lord. With the Lord, she can experience the wonder of the missionary adventure without the need, conscious or unconscious, to be in the first place, to seek or occupy any possible place of preeminence.
¿Cuánto debemos aprender de ustedes?
How much can we learn from you, who are a minority in many of your countries or regions, yet have not let yourselves be carried away or corrupted by an inferiority complex or the complaint that you are not given due recognition?
Por la queja de no sentirse reconocido. Van adelante, anuncian, siembran, rezan, esperan y no pierden la alegría.
Hermanos, so, unidos a Jesús, proclaim, sow the seeds, and don't lose the joy.
Y no tengamos miedo.
Dear brothers, in union with Jesus, we seek what He seeks and we love what He loves. Let us not be afraid to make His priorities our own. You are well aware that yours is a church small in numbers and resources, but full of zeal and eager to be a living instrument of the Lord's loving concern for all the people of your towns and cities. Your commitment to advance that evangelical fruitfulness by proclaiming the kerygma with words and deeds in the various areas where Christians are present is a striking form of witness. A missionary church knows that its best message is its readiness to be transformed by the Word of Life, making service its hallmark. We are not the ones in charge of the mission, and even less our plans and strategies. The Holy Spirit is the true protagonist who propels us as sinners who have been forgiven. He constantly sends us forth to share this treasure in earthen vessels. We have been transformed by the Spirit in order to transform wherever we are placed. The martyrdom of a daily and often silent commitment will bear the fruits your people need. This motivates us to develop a very specific spirituality. The pastor is a person who, in the first place, loves his people deeply and knows their idiosyncrasies, weaknesses, and strengths. Mission is at once a passion for Jesus Christ and a passion for his people. When we stand before the crucified Jesus, we see the depth of his love that exalts and sustains us. But at the same time, unless we are blind, we begin to realize that Jesus' gaze, burning with love, expands to embrace all his people. Let us remember that we too are part of this people. We were chosen to be servants, not masters or managers. This means we are to accompany those whom we serve with patience and kindness. Listening to them, respecting their dignity, always promoting and valuing their apostolic initiatives. Let us not lose sight of the fact that many of your lands were evangelized by the lay faithful. So, no clericalism in the mission. And much less any effort to clericalize the laity. They, the lay faithful, were able to speak the dialect of their people, a simple and direct exercise of enculturation. Neither theoretical nor ideological, but the fruit of their zeal to share Christ. In a particular way, I encourage you always to keep your door open to your priests. the door of your heart, first of all. May we always remember that the closest neighbor of the bishop is the priest. Be close to your priests, listen to them, and seek to accompany them in every situation, especially when you see that they are discouraged or apathetic, which is the worst of the devil's temptations. Do so not as judges, but as fathers. Take up that paternity, not as managers who deploy them, but as true elder brothers, create a climate of trust for honest and open dialogue. Seek and implore the grace to show the same patience with them that the Lord, whose patience is so very great, has shown to each of us. Dear brothers, I know that there are many issues you must confront within your communities, both daily and as you look to the future. May we never lose sight of the fact that in that often uncertain future, it is the Lord Himself who comes with the power of the resurrection to transform every wound into a fountain of life. Let us look to the future in the certainty that we do not journey alone. The Lord is there waiting for us and inviting us to recognize Him above all in the breaking of the bread. Let us beg the intercession of Blessed Nicholas and that of all the many missionary saints so that our people may be renewed with that same anointing. Given the presence here of many bishops from Asia, I take this opportunity to extend my blessing and affection to all your communities, and in a special way, to the sick and to all who are experiencing moments of difficulty. May the Lord bless, care for, and accompany you always. And please do not forget to pray for me and to ask your communities to do the same. Thank you very much. And a round of applause for Pope Francis from the assembled bishops. And the bishops pray together the Ave Maria. The Angelus, excuse me.
Eccentilla Domini. Ave Maria, grazia plena, Dominus tecum. Benedicta tu mulieribus, e benedicto frutto venti tu Iesus. Verbum caro factum est. Ave Maria, grazia plena, Dominus tecum. Benedicta tu mulieribus e benedicto frutto venti tui Jesus. Ora pro nobis santa dei genitrix. Grazie tua in questo Domine, mentibus nostris infunde. Chiance annunziante, Cristi fili tu, incarnazione coniovim, per passione meius ad crucem, a resurrezione gloriam perducamur, per Christum Dominum nostrum. Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto. Requiem eterna donai Domine. Requiescant in pace. Benedicat vos omnipotens Deus, Pater, Filius, et Spiritus Sanctus.
And the Holy Father concludes the Angelus with a blessing of those present. And makes his way to speak with some of the cardinals and bishops. The Holy Father does have a fairly tight schedule. He will be meeting next with the members of the Society of Jesus, the Jesuits, in Thailand. That's become a fairly regular part of his journeys abroad. He'll meet with the Jesuits in the country. Of course, before he was Pope, Jorge Bergoglio was a Jesuit. And he is still very close to the order. He does usually meet with Jesuits in whatever country he visits. And usually in a fairly intimate setting. It's usually a private meeting, but then occasionally we do see the discussions that he has with them in print. That's his next meeting this morning. Later he'll go to Chulalongkorn University, where he'll meet with Christian leaders and leaders of other religions. This afternoon, he's going to the Cathedral of the Assumption, where he will have Holy Mass, especially with young people. After the Mass, the Holy Father is expected to bless 25 cornerstones for new churches in Thailand. And then we'll greet members of the Curia in Bangkok. So that's the Holy Father's schedule for today. It is his last full day in Thailand before he travels tomorrow to Tokyo in Japan. Once again, I would like to greet all those listening in on our partner stations, especially Radio Luce, We Are One Body Radio, Catholic Faith Network, Shalom World TV, Salt and Light TV, EWTN TV, Catholic TV, and CBS News. You've been listening to the live English language commentary for the Holy Father's meeting with priests, religious, and seminarians. And immediately after that, the meeting with the bishops of Thailand and member bishops of the Federation of Asian Bishops Conferences. We do thank you for joining us this morning, and we invite you to tune back in later today for the meeting with Christian leaders and leaders of other religions, which is our next live broadcast. Thank you once again. My name is Christopher Wells. I've been with you this morning for Vatican News. And as always, praised be Jesus Christ. Laudetur Jesus Christus.
Thank you.